our chief guests coming. They're still on the way. First and foremost, adoring for since quite a long time. I do not follow cricket, I'm sorry. I have a game and I'm freezing. Mostly the way I've seen quite a few of your interviews and for settling down or for some personal things. And I always used to tell you, see, let's take Mithali as an inspiration. Let's have her. I have a benchmark now, okay? Maybe it was not there before, but now I have. So there's so much more to her. And I know there are a lot of records and everything. It's just, for me personally, she's like the legend of Indian cricket. Not women's cricket or men's cricket, but Indian cricket. I'm calling onto the stage Ms. Mithali Raj here. And I have a few other friends. There's one friend who has helped me a lot during my writing down my thoughts in form of book. He is an author himself. And I've read a few of his columns. And when a friend introduced me to him, I didn't know that he'd be so humble. And he'd reply and help me. So publishing advisors or in general, yes, and now I'll call another person who is really not my friend but who has been such an integral part whenever I told anyone that I'm writing a book. Okay, his name is Priyadarshi. He's an actor. Yeah.
Nilima, it's a beautiful afternoon of your life when you get to actually release a book. Though it's her life's best amongst the best afternoons, it's also an extraordinary afternoon for me because it's not often that somebody like me gets to sit next to among the two best sportswomen we can have. And also, two extraordinary achievers who have many more things in common, as I'll take you through over the next half an hour or so, post the conversation. We'll obviously love to have your questions and things you'd like to say to either of them. So the next 30-40 minutes, in celebration of this extraordinary achievement, but everything that goes into making it, the challenge of wanting to do something like climb Mount Everest and then actually go and do it. And not once but twice or try a second time. And last 2 days, as I was kind of preparing for this, I found, to my own surprise, that there are amazingly large number of things that are common to cricket and mountaineering. I wouldn't have believed it if you told me this a week ago. And also a lot of similar things in the lives and careers of one of the greatest cricketers, and I won't say women cricketer, one of the greatest cricketers we've had, Mithali Raj. And an amazing adventure sportswoman. Can mountaineering be called an adventure sport? Neelima. So I'll get started, but a small piece of introduction that Neelima didn't know about. Unlike Mithali Raj, I have actually hit a six of the last ball of an over to make my team win. I was also the bowler, so it happens. We all have this fantasy of, you know, playing the last ball of a World Cup. Typically, it will be a Pakistani bowler and you hit a six of the last ball, but I have never played any kind of sport in my life. And I don't think I've climbed more than 3 floors in a building. Therefore, when I'm going to tell you a few things about what I read from your book, but I must tell you, I have acclimatized myself to this theme very well. Now, there are two ways in which you can understand what the challenge of climbing Mount Everest can be like. One is the way Neelima did. Get a coach, get fit, change your diet, lose weight, get fit, go to Nepal, actually meet a Sherpa, go and climb the mountain. The other way, which I did, it's a harder way. I ordered a pizza, sat on my sofa and watched the movie Everest on Amazon Prime. Now that's the harder way to get a sense of Everest. And I'll tell you a few things about Everest. In 1953, when Sherpa Noge and Edmund Hillary, the extraordinary adventurer from New Zealand, who had also done South Pole, climbed Mount Everest, somebody asked them, "Why did you climb Mount Everest?" And he said, "Because it's there. It's there. I want to climb it." I can never understand this. But tell me this, what did Everest do to Edmund Hillary that he said, "It's there, I want to climb it"? Why would anybody want to climb anything so high? I mean, it's crazy, right? Don't you all agree? Why would anybody want to jump into the ocean, jump from an aeroplane, go to the depth of the ocean, climb it? And if you don't believe, from 1953 for about 40 years, very few people tried to climb Everest. And the death rate was 25%. One of four people who tried to climb Mount Everest never came back. There was this possible instance of Mallory possibly climbed before Norgay and Hillary. We don't know. But Mallory's body was found. He went on an expedition in 1924, in the 1990s. 70 years, his body was not even recovered. That's the kind of frightening challenge this represents. It was Rob Hall, really, who changed it all with a company called Adventure Consultants. He took about 20 expeditions of amateurs without a single death, and Mount Everest opened up. You spoke about this. I mean, I also add this. Mount Everest, the name is very interesting. Just that, and then I'll ask you to answer this. In Nepali, it's called Sagar Mata, the mother mountain, you know, like we call ocean and rivers mother, which is the name you call her. So for you, Mount Everest is not a rock with ice. It's a mother. And then the whole book is in the form of soliloquy, a conversation you have with the mother. So I'll ask you to connect these two and say, what is it that you as a mountaineer see in a mountain? What is it you hear a mountain say to you, which we normal people perhaps do not hear or see? What is it? Why does a mountain call a human being saying, "Surrender yet conquer"?
Sagar, as in how we know Sagar is we know Sagar as ocean, but there's another meaning to Sagar in Sanskrit. It is called as Sagar is also in Sanskrit, it means infinity, like this infinite, like how you see the ocean, it looks it's just limitless. And then there is Matha. It's not the Matha like mother, it's Matha like the forehead. So Sagar Matha translates into the forehead of the universe, forehead of infinity. That's what it actually means. What it means to me, it means so many things. When I started off my first time, when I saw Mount Everest and I thought, this is Sagar Matha, I want to climb it. It felt very personal. My first look, the first time I saw it was in the face of the earthquake. And for me, I felt at that time, if I would have been in any other place, I would have died. But just because I was there, I felt safe. There was a kind of connect, spiritual connect to it. And the name Sagar Matha connected to me a lot. But during the journey, I realized that there are so many meanings that Mount Everest carries for me. So many. Like, it's just to get to, the Everest, such a financial, you have to climb a financial mountain first. So that, it meant that for me at some time. And then sometime it also meant for me that I'll have to fight the system. There's so many things I'll have to do. And start fighting from where? So every time it was a mountain for me. So the definitions kept changing every time. Even when I scaled, it meant I had this withdrawal symptoms. It meant, I didn't know what it meant suddenly. Like that was the best thing I've ever seen. And I didn't have words to talk about it. I put myself in silence for a long time because I just did not want to waste words. So it meant so many different things at different times.
So just beating the sequence of questions I had in mind, because one of our guests now arrived. I'd like to invite you, but I'll invite her with a question to you first. How much was the support from the government of Andhra Pradesh important to you to be actually able to achieve your dream of trying to do a financially, how expensive is a trip to Mount Everest, if I had to put it so simply, besides your preparation? Financially, what's the cost of wanting to get there? How significant was the support of the government of AP? And then we'll call her.
So, when I started off trying to finance my expedition, there were very few people who believed in me. And I had to put in a lot of effort in terms of financial, basically I put in a lot of savings myself because I had a corporate job at that time and I used to earn. But for a dream as big as Everest, I had to put all of myself, I had to give all of myself. That means quitting a job and a lot of other things. You have to give yourself and you definitely need sponsors. And my first major breakthrough came from the government of Andhra Pradesh. And I remember I used to go around Sports Authority of Andhra Pradesh for, allowing for some kind of support. And there was no process involved. That time, the MD and VC for Sports Authority of Andhra Pradesh was Rekha Rani Garu, who's here with us. And there was no policy for adventure sports. But she believed in my conviction. And one day she took me to the Honorable Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, Chandrababu Naidu Garu. And he gave me a major breakthrough, 15 lakhs of sponsorship. That was my breakthrough. And then followed other sponsors.
But without it wouldn't have been possible. So, Madam Rekha Rani Garu, I invite you on stage. possibly unveil another copy, a bouquet for her, please.
Thank you for coming and I request you to please unveil the books.
I think we can. Yeah, yet again. Sorry, this is like, you know. And or a helicopter and just get down, and we realize that at about 10,000 feet above sea level, you're in ways you can't imagine. 10,000 feet, normal people limbs react. 12,000 feet, less than 0.0001% of mankind actually has been there, lives there, can survive. This camp of Everest, 17,000 feet, one of the most difficult terrains on the planet. Everest, 29029 feet, is a place where you die basically. And this is what some of the best mountaineers say. Your body actually. So tell me once again, I ask you, as a person who has no sense of adventure, who doesn't have the courage to do. That's the adventure sport I indulge in occasionally. Tell me, what craving within you to do something so impossible, so risky, so defiant? I ask you this because it's so inconceivable, isn't it? Would you like to, how many of you in your life? Anyone here? Wow, wow, wow. All the best. If you do a book, I'll be happy to launch it.
Like I said, it was a calling. There was a spiritual, something very, there was spiritual connect involved. But like along the way, the reasons kept changing. One of the reasons were a strong anger. There was an anger in me that why was there no woman, you know, from
Andhra Pradesh. You're the first woman from Andhra Pradesh to actually even attempt
to climb Everest. So I was a little taken aback. Why is there no person? And whenever I'm going to the mountains or, you know, for the Everest base camp or just trekking, I used to see a lot of people from other states, other countries, and we used to interact. And people used to like, oh, you're from Andhra Pradesh. Like, oh, okay. So that's where it all started. And slowly I got to know that most of the states have their mountaineers. They have...
But does Andhra Pradesh have now?
Now, yes. Now, Andhra Pradesh has the most number of mountaineers who've scaled AP now.
Amazing. So here's a pioneer instance, and now I'll go to Mithali and ask this question. When did you get this feeling, this be a cricketer? Or was it just give it a shot? Did the game give you the same kind of magical calling? Neelima writes about how mountains are different on every day, the breeze is different. Does the pitch, does the same magical evocation in you? How does it feel when you wear your pads and gloves, carry the bat and go each time? Speak to us about how cricket happened to you.
I think when you asked me of the spiritual, my eyes with my mother, because she knows how I actually started playing, because I never had a calling. It was probably my dad who got the spiritual calling and he pushed me into the sport. It was never from me. I think once when you are into something like this for a long time, because I started cricket way back in 1992 as a nine-year-old kid, and today I'm 35, so it's been a very long journey. After a certain period, you realize it's part of you, and you know, it takes so much of your time in everyday life that I have missed so many things to be where I am. So today I can see it is, you know, it defines me probably. It's my identity as a woman cricketer that I'm known around the world. And I wouldn't say a calling, but I do strongly believe that I'm destined to be a cricketer, because there were so many times along the way that I had made choices, but it always drifted towards being a cricketer. So could be that, you know, I'm destined to be a cricketer. I've also like her. You know, I'm a trained classical Bharatanatyam dancer, but I could not pursue it. I have learned piano, but I couldn't pursue it. So there were so many other things as a hobby which I started, but I ended up being a cricketer. So yeah.
So I'll come to the price you pay and price the moms and dads pay in a bit. But do you know, how many of you here know that Kapil Dev captained Indian cricket team in the World Cup finals once? Sourav Ganguly did it once. Dhoni did it once. Mithali Raj is the only Indian cricketer to have done it twice. She's also the highest run getter in the women's cricket. 6,000 runs in her career so far in going. And this is a huge number if you see cricket even from the men's perspective. Some of you may not know, but Sunny Gavaskar batted 60 overs in a World Cup, and one day overs used to be 60 overs those days. He carried his bat, 36 not out in a 60 over match. 2,000 runs in one day cricket used to be a great achievement for men's cricket till about 1988-89. So it's an extraordinary sportswoman and a sportsman, if you like, gender neutral context. She's among the greats in sport in India. I'd like to now ask you something. Do you feel, because of the success and the glamour and the hype of men's cricket, we have been unfair to you? Just because you are a woman, I mean, not many people may have watched you score all those runs, or till recently, your previous World Cup final, nobody was even possibly aware that you were in the finals or doing so well, etc.
Well, it could be a part of it, but not the factor for being unreasonable towards women's cricket, because even men's cricket in 80s or 70s wasn't as popular as was what it is today. It could be because of the medium. I think television is one medium which reaches out to everybody. The television started and the color picture started in 90s. That's when cricket actually brought in big names. And today we have social media, which has taken on, which is much more bigger than the television. Unfortunately for women's cricket, we couldn't be seen much on television in 90s and probably even till late last year. So I think the number of matches that now we've been playing after the World Cup has captivated a lot of people. They whenever I do a lot of these events, people do tend to show me a lot of curiosity about what is women's cricket, how are the women cricketers, and what is the dressing room gossips, because they are very keen to know, like, how the male cricketers are. Is women's cricket similar to it? So there is a lot of this curiosity in people to know more about women's cricket, but we continue to extend the brand, provided we are more, our matches are more televised, because these days the more you see, that's the first-hand impression that you get. If I see someone play on television live, I form my own opinion, whereas if I just read a newspaper article, I'm reading someone else's opinion. So I think it is a huge difference to reading an article and watching it live on television, and that is what has made to change the way people look at women's cricket, or the way people think about women playing this sport in our country. Because for a long period, cricket was more related to men. I mean, if anybody would have asked cricket or talk about cricket, there were only male cricketers were mentioned in a round table discussion. But today it has changed. Today people do talk about women's cricket, talk about our matches, and know each and every member of the women's team. So it has come a long way, but I think in this process, people's perception towards women athlete or women taking up sports as a career in our country has changed in these years, with so many women athletes coming into foray, being shattering the glass ceiling, I would say that, because people have never seen a woman athlete as a role model. You know, I think that is something which has changed in the last few years.
Sure, in the 80s, I remember P.T. Usha would be the one Indian athlete we would speak about, and then Shiny Wilson many, many years later, almost had nobody. I want both of you to comment and then pass the mic to her, possibly she will give a perspective. What is it about super successful women athletes in Hyderabad? We have been producing the champions in every sport, mountaineering, cricket, next door badminton, Saina, Sindhu and before that Sania Mirza in lawn tennis. What is it about one city that is catapulting? Do you in turn inspire each other? Does Sindhu or a Saina inspire you? Do they feel inspired by your success, vice versa? So speak about how Hyderabad has suddenly become the capital or the epicenter of the success of women in sports and the creation of icons. Well, this because it will make newspaper headlines too.
Well, I think this is a very common question asked these days, because when people ask me from where I am, so I tell them that I'm from Hyderabad. So they do ask me this question. So to be a little on a funnier side, I say Hyderabad biryani is one common thing which between the athletes. But I think there are a few factors, like Hyderabad has always promoted sports, and especially the government. Whenever there are any athletes, women athletes who've performed exceptionally well at international level, the government has always acknowledged and recognized their efforts. And even the local media, I would say, has actually contributed to this, because I don't see any other state which has written articles on these athletes when they were very young. I remember, Subramaniam, who wrote my first interview when I was, when I was 13 or 14 years.
Amazing.
Yeah, so I think it is also the media to an extent which has given us that boost as a very young athletes, and people had a lot to read about us. And I think any sportsman is an inspiration, not necessarily it has to be a woman athlete, but each and every sportsperson, we look up to each other to inspire, because mostly our struggles, our challenges are very similar, and we know what it takes to be a sportsperson in our country.
So to take the headline out of it, coaches, their families, but the media. Somebody who's written and been part of the Hyderabad media, I feel so flattered, even though I don't believe her.
It's my childhood, so I do not connect to her answers. So for me, I've taken up sports hardly 4 or 5 years. Until mountaineering, I never ran, I never did anything except my Bharatanatyam and yoga. That's all I used to do. And suddenly, the whole body dynamics had to change. Everything had to change. But I agree with her when she says that the media support has always been there. That's one thing that's constantly been there with me. Otherwise, I don't know, in 2015, I mean, there were so many people out there who were there from India and in other states also, who were stuck at the earthquake, and they were rescued also, so many other mountaineers. But I took the headlines that time, and it gave me a lot of mileage for me to pitch myself to the sponsors. So after that also, 2016 Everest, I think every time, I became a Pinkathon ambassador, I ran. I think every time the media was there with me. This is one point I do agree. And like she says, I do not have a lot of sports friends, because I do not come from a sports background. So, and my sport being mountaineering, I see most of my friends out there in the outdoors, and we rarely meet. It's like we suddenly stumble upon each other in some climb or some trek. That's and we are super happy, but that's all. But I do see when I go to Gopi Anna's academy, when I see all these people sitting and eating, and I feel so jealous sometimes, because when I go out with my friends, most of my friends do not understand why I do not.
Because eat. Your sport is so boring. I mean, you can't see it on TV. I mean, somebody climbing mountain for 30 days. What can you show on TV? You can't even make a movie on you realize. Because the person will be climbing, watching. So you can't help it. Like, look, badminton is also not the most televisable sport, but it's being caught.
The kind of determination you have, if you should have taken tennis, something like that. But
you can't imagine Mithali playing badminton or Sania
exactly.
Playing cricket, or not anymore, obviously, because it peaked success, but
yeah.
You never thought so. Nobody told you that besides her and me.
Oh,
now.
Yeah, and then my trait of determination, mountaineering, it doesn't have a lot of recognition. That comes always, that's always there for me. But like Mithali says, you are destined to it. You take diversions and then you come back. That is what I felt with Everest, or basically that is what I feel still with mountaineering. I take diversion, I wrote a book, and I want to come back. and I do want do something else, I just want to come back.
So I'll like you to comment on, I mean, I promise myself I'll not say
anything. Neelima for her book release, From Everest with Love, and seeing the beautiful captain out here, the place is looking very happy, and I would like to go ahead with your question. Yes, what Mithali has said is government has definitely played a large impact on sports, especially if you've seen in 2000 the sort of infrastructure we have come in was the stadium out in Gachibowli here, and that was the initial stage when the present CM of Andhra Pradesh had just come in, and then we had come in with national games where it was very important to have the best infrastructure, and it was done in 100 days. If you recollect, it was done in 100 days, and the infrastructure facilities for sports have improved. And just then, I think Gopi Chand was given the academy to start, and then the success started from there. After that, Sanya was player. She played the women's tournament at LB Stadium. That was a turning point. So you have all these success stories where government surely played a major role. Then you see PV Sindhu, who was initially from Telangana. I proudly would like to mention this, that this was again a very healthy step taken by government of Andhra Pradesh, especially the present Chief Minister, Sri Nara Chandrababu Naidu Garu, who said, yes, when Sindhu has come to finals, either she's going to be the runner-up or she's going to get into the finals. So I recollect that day, you know, when they wanted to prepare what she has to be given. That was what they had thought, that okay, this girl hails from Andhra, so what is the best we can gift her? And then of course the prize money was definitely a larger attraction. Beyond that, there was something else which needed a longevity, and she was offered the Group 1 post.
Yes.
As a deputy collector. That was most important for a career, you know. Everybody thinks after sports what, or rather they get into central government jobs. But then again Shrikant also proved. Today Shrikant is also deputy collector. So this is a great step forward for a lot of students who think, yes, studying in Narayana or Chaitanya or any other academic institutions looking for marks is not only the only thing to get into bigger education qualifications, but even sports is not small. Now sports is also equally charming as other professional things what a child should get into. So not only that, I would like to say one more thing. This is the first of its kind that government in India, I think after Hari Bharjan Singh, who is DSP.
Yes.
It is only Sindhu today who is deputy collector, and then after that is Shrikant. So I proudly say that Andhra Pradesh government has given a lot of importance to sports and will continue to do that.
So I'll think about it. When they took their first steps, and we are talking.
When you take up sports, there is no guarantee that you will make it to playing the highest level, because that itself also has various stages that a sports person has to go through. Whereas when you study engineering or doctor, you know that, you know, at some point you have a job, you will end up having a job. So I think that sports in our country is still a very big gamble, which the parents, not everyone are ready to take that gamble for the children. But as a sports person, when I started very young, there have been a lot of challenges, because I definitely will talk about the challenges which I have faced and probably have seen my parents face. Maybe they are in a better position to say as parents what challenges they have faced. But as a young kid, the first challenge I have faced is that, you know, I have seen a lot of academies only filled with boys, whether they are young or old enough. But I was the only girl who were in an academy full of boys. So that was a different reality for me as a young kid. And after playing India also, I've never got the basic infrastructure that you get as an international player, because I was training on matting and then you play international on turf wicket. So I had very little time to adjust and acclimatize. It's a challenge, but today's generation, if you compare 90s and, you know, to 2018, today's young girls will never have those kind of experience where they have to see only boys. Today when I see academies, they have a lot, many girls. There are at least 15 to 20 girls who are training at one session, or the young girls who straight away have the facilities like the best ground. There is such a professional setup. When I was an international cricketer in 2005, when I had an injury, I never had a proper place to go and show my injury, whether I would be, you know, to get it treated. But today, when someone is injured, they are straight away sent to National Cricket Academy, where you have the best of physios and trainers. So the injured person is also taken care of. We never had central contracts, but today I'm a central contract player. The board looks after their players. So you know that even though if you get injured tomorrow, you are still taken care of the board, which the cushioning I didn't have in 90s. So I think because of these circumstances, a lot of talented cricketers had to let go, because after a certain period, you know, your parents are asking you to settle down, or your parents want you to be financially good enough, you know, so they start to work, they start to get in search of other jobs, other career options. So cricket was never a viable option back in 90s, whereas now everybody think it is good enough with the IPL, with so much of money coming in. Even even if you don't make it as an international player, you play a normal state level, you're still earning good enough to live a very comfortable life. So I think these things have changed, and that is why I think today's parents are not shy away from, in fact I can use this word, pushing the young kids to take up sport. Even though if a kid is not keen to take up sports, they think this is a very good option of, you know, getting something in return.
That's the thing with middle class. Please give them the round of applause. May I have the father of Nilima as well here, please. Sir, please come. These are the parents who, quite some time before it was fashionable for sport as a career, gave the encouragement and support, and don't forget, it's very, very important. So thank you. Because of you, we have...
question is the fears. Because when Mithali was speaking, I was just thinking, it's a completely different world. Mountaineering, that sport defies all sport, because whatever happens down here, whatever game you are playing down here in the plains, cricket, football, any game, you are rest assured that should something happen to you, you have a doctor, you'll go there, you'll get treated, or you'll bounce back from your injury. But this is something that we cannot afford as a mountaineer. You go against all the rules, against oxygen, against wind, against gravity, everything. So the fears are still the same. So the fears have not changed. So my parents, if I'm... So sometimes when I read my book, I go up to my mom and I ask, what made you encourage me? Why did you think why did you encourage me? So my mom's reply is, that's a $1 million question. I also do not know. That's my mom's answer. So that's the answer I give. And the other side is that when the Sherpas, they go to the mountain every year, they do not want their children. So the fears remain same every...
They want them to get education and get into normal careers.
Yes,
and
exactly. So the fears are the same.
So here the amazing Sherpas who are not afraid to climb Everest 4 times, but they are scared for their next generation because they may not earn enough money climbing mountains or trekking, and they want them to pursue other kind of careers. Fascinating, yes.
And you respect them. The guru, whatever the guru says, you do without any question. That is the sampradayam that we call. And that helped me when I came to sports, that helped me a lot. I never once questioned my trainer, and there used to be a constant interaction between me and my trainer. My trainer was my guru. The trainer will ask me to jump into a well, I'll do it. And here I have to introduce my trainer. He's here. His name is Suresh. Is he
Suresh
here?
Suresh Garu.
He's here.
Come so here, sir. Please come here. 1 minute, please.
Please.
Let the world see you. Very nice of you to Please.
So he's always this person who will sit in the last. So he's been there with me throughout.
Would you say a few words about... Please have a seat. Yeah.
So, how I know Suresh is through another friend of mine who teaches yoga. And when she used to say that, you know what, my husband is a marathon runner. He's a national level sprinter initially. And then he moved on to marathons. And his weekly mileage is 40 to 50 kilometers per day.
He runs per 40 week. Kilometers a week.
A week. 40 to 50, that was the mileage when I first knew him 4 years ago. But things have changed so much. I think he must be running around 100 a week now. But that was the time when I'm like, what?
I'd like to now change the language just for the next few minutes for the benefit of the audience, which is mixed. Could you tell me in Telugu how Suresh Garu has... Okay, I should begin. Suresh Garu, mee jeevithamlo ee discipline, physical fitness tevadam valla, mee sports career lo enta labhadayakam ayindi, enta important. ఒక స్పోర్ట్స్
నా డిసిప్లిన్ కమిట్మెంట్ ఇవన్నీ నాకు భరతనాట్యం నుంచి వచ్చింది. పొద్దునే లేవడం, గురువు మాట వినడం, ఇవన్నీ నాకు అక్కడ నుంచి వచ్చింది అనమాట. అండ్ వన్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ ఇక్కడ ఇంపార్టెంట్ థింగ్ ఏంటంటే, నా భరతనాట్యం గురువుకి నాకు సేమ్ అనమాట ట్రైనర్. సో మా ఇద్దరికి అంటే ఆల్రెడీ ఆయనకు తెలుసు నా మెంటాలిటీ ఎక్కడి నుంచి వస్తుందో. సో అక్కడ నుంచి అడాప్ట్ చేసుకుని అది స్పోర్ట్స్లో ఎలా మారాలి, నా బాడీ కూడా, ఐ మీన్ మై దెర్ వాజ్ లాట్ ఆఫ్ గ్రేస్ ఇన్ మై బాడీ, బట్ అది చేంజ్ చేయాలన్నమాట. ఒక అథ్లెటిక్ ఫ్రేమ్కి చేయాలి ఎవ్రీథింగ్, అది ప్రతి ఒక్కటి చూసుకున్నారు సురేష్ సార్. అండ్ మై ఐ నెవర్ కాల్ ఎనీ వన్ సార్ బట్ ఎక్సెప్ట్ హిమ్. సో నా న్యూట్రిషన్ కూడా అండి, నాకు ఏమీ తెలియదు అనమాట ఇనిషియల్గా, బికాజ్ యూఆర్ నాట్ టాట్ సో మచ్ ఇన్ భరతనాట్యం. యూ జస్ట్ డూ ఇట్ కార్బ్స్ విత్ కార్బ్ లోడింగ్ అండ్ జస్ట్ డూ ఇట్. బట్ ఇట్ వాజ్ హిమ్, హీ ఇంట్రడ్యూస్ మీ టు సో మెనీ కాన్సెప్ట్స్ దట్ ఐ నెవర్ న్యూ అప్పట్లో.
ఇందాక మీరు ఒక విషయం చెప్పారు, హైదరాబాద్ నుంచి భారతదేశంలోనే కాకుండా
గవర్నమెంట్ కొంచెం కదిలిందంటే అది మీడియా వల్ల అండి, లేకపోతే అసలుకి మౌంటైనీరింగ్ గురించి ఎవరికి తెలియదు డౌన్ సౌత్, ఇక్కడ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ కానివ్వండి తెలంగాణ కానివ్వండి అంతగా తెలియలేదు అనమాట. 2015 ఎర్త్ క్వేక్ తర్వాత మీడియా అసలుకి ఏంటి మౌంటైనీరింగ్ ఎంత రిస్కీ స్పోర్ట్ అండ్ ఎంత బట్ ఎందుకు ఇంకా వెళ్తున్నారు మౌంటైనీరింగ్ చేయడానికి, అండ్ మన ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్లో ఎవరు లేరు మౌంటైనియర్స్ ఆర్ అమ్మాయిలు ఎవరు లేరు ఎక్కిన వాళ్ళు, ఇదంతా గవర్నమెంట్ దృష్టికి తీసుకొచ్చింది మీడియా వాళ్ళు. అండ్ 2016 అప్పుడు కూడా నాకు చాలా సపోర్ట్ ఇచ్చిందండి మీడియా, హెస్ ప్లేడ్ అ పివోటల్ రోల్ ఇన్ మై మౌంటైనీరింగ్ కెరియర్.
మీ కదిలేదు కానీ మిథాలి గారు కూడా చెప్పాము, ఆయన 13 ఏళ్ల వయస్సులో మొదటి మాకు న్యూస్ పేపర్లు I had gurinch that
few years back, and ironically I think one of my favorite books is Jeffrey Archer's Paths of Glory, is also on mountaineering only, and how someone who scales Mount Everest, who never, people don't know, that's actually the true story, people don't know whether he's actually scaled the highest peak or you know what happened in the middle, but his letters to his wife and how he's challenged when he's leading a group of people onto the mountain. So I think that has also each and every book which I read in some way or the other inspires me, changes my thinking, because we are so limited when we in today's world we talk to different people, but we are so closed in our heads. But when you read books, you know that you're not the only person who makes mistakes, you're not the only person who's challenged, there are so many other people, so many other characters who go through the different challenges, and how one tries to seek inspiration from common man. Because today you'd ask me, you know, who's my inspiration, I wouldn't name anybody very big, because for me a common man, an average man, can also inspire me with the way he conducts himself in his day-to-day life. So you find inspiration, you find those few anecdotes in different books which help you to understand life, and also helps you in times when I'm on tours, when I have to take very difficult situation or decisions with regards to my team. It helps me to have a very composed and sorted mind, because you know what is expected of you, you know how to channel your thoughts, and it has helped me a lot in being the person that I am. It helped me as a leader, and it has also helped me to deal with other things in life. So books have always helped me with my perception, And it has also helped me if I have to deal with anxiety, because as you mentioned, when it is a big day or a big match, it is but natural for any sports person to get nervous, because the expectations are too high when you represent India at the international level. So to give your best each time you walk in, you want to be zoned out, you want to focus on your skill. So I think for me, because it's a very individual thing everyone follows, for me to get out of that nervousness, I reach out for a book. So that's how I think you've seen me read before I went into bat.
And I must say, as a cricket lover,
she was a journalist long time back. I remember as a child, my sister, in fact, I was very young. I remember my sister, how she learned letters was like P-A-P-A. Amma amma ni peru ochindi, amma ni peru ochindi, article ochindi roju. That's how she learned. I was not so, I was a little dumb probably. I didn't learn that way. But my mother did encourage me into writing at a very early age, because as a child I had issues, some skill development issues, and I couldn't speak up a lot. So it was my mom who gave me a book and a pen, and she asked me to scribble or write or do whatever you want. And I started to understand that writing, it gives you that, it keeps you focused, it keeps you centered. So every time I'm disturbed, I write. Every time I'm happy, I write. So whenever I, basically it keeps you calm. That's why I write. But later I realized that so many other people, when I was reading my poems in my school, or when my poems were published in newspapers, and people used to write back to me telling that they can relate to my emotions. And at a later point, when I read my own poems and my own whatever I wrote in the book, when I was depressed, they used to cheer me up. So that's where it all started. And then of course, not a huge reader, mostly I used to be a writer, and I used to read only the meanings and how to use these sentences. That's what I used to read. But
you've written the book very well. I mean, I've read the book and it's very well written. So
thank you.
Now I'll open it up to questions. Just one last question. I have to be a little naughty here.
Here you're pushing me to be the first. Well, I would keep that confession for my own book, because my book is releasing in September end. So I would keep it for that, because you all should have something to read, something to know more. So, yeah.
But is it something that's happened to you many times? Would you at least tell me that?
What do you mean by many times?
Maybe like, you're a sports icon, wherever you go, you travel so much. Do men come up with love letters, flowers, proposals, rings?
Well, I think that is something, that there's a lot of fan following, so it is but natural for people to express their love in different ways. And
the rest in your book.
Yeah, the rest in my book.
I think it's called Unguarded, right?
Yeah.
Yes, caught. Unguarded. Okay. Me, I think this fan following and everything, it came at a very later stage of my life, because basically I was not into sports. Suddenly the world changed for me, and everyone wanted to be with me. And like, yeah, most guys, they were flirting with me. So it came at a very later stage, and by the time I think I already know, okay, this is not real, or this is not that. So that is the difference, that's all.
So I need one volunteer who will take the mic round the audience as people ask questions. There's a mic here, somebody please help. You'll do that? Okay, hands.
I don't know, because I'm still a current player, I'm still playing, so starting an academy, then it's a full-time job. And as a coach, you need to be there throughout the day guiding your students. Right now I cannot give that much time, because I'm still playing. Maybe whenever I call it the day, then I probably will think in those lines. But I might end up opening only for women's cricket, probably, yeah.
Hunting question. What? What next? So I have a very nice answer for you, because I have recently set up my own company. It's called Third Pole Adventures. So your next is my next.
Good to be.
I'm kind of testing, because they wanted to know how you know, women's IPL will turn out, if at all they manage to have. But right now, in today's time, we still don't have that many pool of players to form, say, 8 franchises. So we probably need another couple of years to get in so many players. And playing with the international players, it was a very awesome experience, because you don't get to play these kind of matches still in women's cricket. And Australia and England have started their leagues. We are yet to start. But to see them turn out for the exhibition match and the kind of response we had in terms of viewership, we didn't attract too many people in the stadium because the timing wasn't great, because in Mumbai's heat at 2 o'clock you don't expect people to turn up for the match. But we did have a lot of people following it on social media, on the television, so that way it has garnered a lot of attention from people. And I never thought I would get to be part of something like this during my playing days. I'm only glad that it is happening while I'm playing. I'm still playing.
Any other questions?
You know, unconsciously trying to talk more about gender rather than pitted against each other, why not have a mixed, so that, you know, at the end of the day, it's the sport which garners more attention or more mileage, and we promote sports. But having said that, we do play a lot of matches with the boys whenever we are, you know, preparing for international tours, because we know when you play against boys, you don't get anything easy. They're as fiercely competitive as anything else. And I think that is a larger part why, you know, as a woman cricketer, I could come so far, is because when I train with the boys day in and day out, even in Hyderabad, I know that, you know, each training session requires me to be the best, because the, you know, once you hit them for a 4, you know, the next ball is aimed at your head. That usually happens with the boys because they don't like the girls, you know, hitting them for boundaries or for sixes or, you know, getting the wicket. But then that is something, as a cricketer, I've always enjoyed, is that competition on the field where you're looked as a competitor and not as a woman competitor or a male competitor. We are all playing a sport and it has to be gender free. You shouldn't see male or female in that. You just have to see a player, you have to see a competitor. So I think it would be great, but right now the standard of men's cricket, it is just not limited to skill. They are too much into strength. And honestly, I think we probably cannot match them in terms of physical strength. So I don't know if it makes sense to you know, play against the Indian men's team, but probably the, you know, India A or something like that would be a decent one.
Any more questions, please?
Okay, I think it is it's great evening because we. I'm at the book launch of Neelima, and I've come here because for a fact that she is the first woman to scale Mount Everest, and her book also talks about her experience and challenges that she faced while climbing the peak. And it is something that I love reading books. I've read a lot of books, and even one of my favorites has been Paths of Glory by Jeffrey Archer, which also talks about mountaineering. And I think it will be a good read, and I'm going to definitely read this book, and I really wish her all the very best. She is one of those like us who've break the glass ceiling, who's not limited herself, because there have not been women earlier in this field, but she's someone who started, and I'm sure there are many more young girls while reading her book will be you know, motivated, inspired to take up that field.
Thank you all, andaru vachinanduku. Thanks a lot. Actually, meeku gurtunte 2015 lo nenu first time Everest base camp kani Nepal ki vellanu. Appudu earthquake lu chikkukodamu adi media vallane adi government drushtiki velli, dan tarvata naaku malli financial support and chaala sponsors support vachi, nenu 2016 nenu I became the first woman from Andhra Pradesh to make a summit attempt on Everest. So dani tarvata mottam mechanics of mountaineering mottam Andhra Pradesh state lo change ayipoyind anamata. And today we have the most number of mountaineers from Andhra Pradesh who scaled the Everest and other major peaks. So I take nenu oka 1 year gap teeskoni na mountaineering career గ్యాప్ తీసుకొని నేను బుక్ రాసానండి. ఆ బుక్ పేరు వచ్చి ఫ్రమ్ ఎవరెస్ట్ విత్ లవ్. దిస్ ఇస్ టు ఇన్స్పైర్ అదర్ ఈ జనరేషన్, రాబోయే జనరేషన్ కిడ్స్ వాళ్ళందరూ చదివి ఇన్స్పైర్ అయ్యి వాళ్ళ వాళ్ళ ఫీల్డ్స్ అది సెలెక్ట్ చేసుకొని దాంట్లో వాళ్ళు ఎక్సెల్ అవుతారు అని ఒక ఫోర్ థాట్ తోటి నేను బుక్ రాసానండి. థ్యాంక్స్ అ లాట్. థ్యాంక్ యూ సో మచ్.